What's up, guys? Vulcan here, and with New Worlds beta coming next week, I figured now would be an awesome time to put together a massive guide to help anyone interested in the game learn more about it. And this is one of the most comprehensive guides that I've ever put together. So I hope you guys really enjoy it, and please use the timestamps below to find what you're looking for. So to get things started, let's talk about some general info about New World. So one, the beta begins on July 20th on Steam. And if you would like to access the beta, you do need to either pre-order to get access, and pre-ordering starts at $40, or you can try your chance at a key by signing up on the website. Now, if you were someone who pre-ordered for free back in 2016, which seems like an eternity ago, you'll get an email with a Steam key from Amazon to download the game. So the beta is going to run until August 2nd, which is about 2 weeks, and the official launch is August 31st, 2021. This one is fairly set in stone. Hopefully, we don't see another delay. Now, I have linked the system requirements below for anyone who actually needs them, and a couple other kind of housekeeping items. There is no subscription fee to play New World. You just need to buy a box copy, and that's it. There will be a cash shop in the game, but after a lot of community pushback, New World removed things like experience boosters and other pay-to-win items, so it's just going to be skins and cosmetics for now. So let's talk about the game itself. So what is New World? Isn't it a PvP survival game? Well, not exactly. So New World is no longer that survival sandbox or PvP-centric MMO. It's now closer to a traditional MMO with a heavy emphasis on crafting, PvP warfare, exploration, and dungeon delving. It takes place on the supernatural island called Aeternum, and it's home to all kinds of weird creatures, beasts, and corruption. So they kind of got rid of the whole conquistador, you know, we're going through and exploring the new world type of thing, and they focused entirely on, here's this weird kind of mysterious island that we crash landed on, and there's all sorts of like magic and corruption and stuff that we need to discover. So moving away from the realism and moving a bit into more of a hybrid between realism mixed with kind of that dark magic. So the map itself is divided into 12 zones, and each of them can be claimed and captured by different factions. When a faction claims a territory, they will receive a special bonus that's faction-wide. We'll get into factions and those bonuses here in a little bit. Now, there are no mounts in the game. I know a lot of people were really looking forward to like horses and things like that. Those are not there. You will be running everywhere you go, so please get comfortable with running. And this is a fairly massive world, so you will be hoofing it pretty much everywhere. Now, there is a limited version of fast travel you can either recall to your last inn, which is on a 1 hour cooldown timer, or you can use a currency known as Azoth to fast travel to any settlement that you've been to. So that's it for kind of the general overview and the game section itself. Let's go ahead and move into questing. So when it comes to leveling up to 60, you can do it in a combination of ways. There are faction missions, town projects, side missions, and the main story quests. Now, the main story quests are spread out across your journey to 60, and they won't always be right after one another, so you will need to do some leveling in between them. And this is where those other sources of experience will come from. So you have faction missions. Now, faction missions are opened up at level 10 when you first choose a faction to join. Like I said, we'll dive deeper into those individual factions here in a little bit. But these are quick tasks that will ask the player to do some simple things, and they're split into two categories. You have PvE and PvP. For your PvE tasks, you'll need to kill a certain amount of enemies, collect a number of trinkets, clear an area. For PvP, it's often traveling to another settlement, clearing an area, or gathering something, and you have to be opted into PvP for this, which is where the high risk, high reward comes from. Now, most of these are very quick to complete. They're very simple. It's just go kill 10 wolves, go gather 10 of these items, but these are often spread out and around the settlement that you pick them up in, so you'll be able to go out there, explore, gather some other things. And most of the time, the world is designed to sidetrack you. So you will be out there, you'll see a named boss, you'll see something happening, and it'll kind of pull you away from that. So these are quick to complete, but be aware, you will get distracted. And once you complete these, they will reward you with experience as well as a faction currency that you can use to purchase faction-specific gear. Now, I personally like the look of the Covenant and the Syndicate, very kind of Plague Doctor and Witch Hunter looking. And then lastly, you have the Marauders, which are more soldiers. So another source of experience are the town projects, and these are found at the bulletin board near Town Hall, These are full of random tasks that are similar to faction quests, though these will contain things like crafting, gathering, and slaying, and you can complete these however you'd like to. If you have the money, you can really just go to the auction house and buy the crafted items or buy the materials and then quickly turn them in. At the end of the day, all that matters is you actually have the item in your inventory. And in terms of experience, this is the best way to level up outside of story missions. These are incredibly quick to complete, they give massive amounts of experience compared to faction missions, and they're constantly refreshing. And then we have side missions, and side missions can be found within each settlement. These are often linked to some form of side progression, whether it's leveling up your campsite or unlocking a new gear slot for your character. Then we have the main missions, and these main missions are your milestones within your leveling journey, and these will often come with some big unlock that's going to enhance your character. This can be a new weapon or gear slot, and like I mentioned earlier, these will be spread out as you level up, so you're going to need to do some grinding in between to help bridge them. So next, let's talk about gear. So when it comes to gear in New World, you're looking at a pretty standard arsenal. You have a slew of weapons to choose from that range in your typical kind of rainbow of rarities from common to legendary. And as items become more rare, they gain more affixes and bonuses, which makes them more powerful. Now, don't expect anything crazy like you'd find in an isometric action RPG, right? This isn't Diablo or Path of Exile, but still, these affixes will be things like increasing all void damage or causing you to reduce cooldowns whenever you deal damage. And in terms of slots for your character, you have 2 weapon slots, 5 armor slots, which are your helm, body, legs, gloves, and feet, 3 accessory slots, 3 bag slots, and a shield slot. Now, one kind of pro tip here, take off your shield when you aren't using your sword. It adds extra weight and it's going to push you into a heavier category, which affects your dodge roll and the bonus that you get from your weight category. So speaking of weight, when you wear armor, you have 3 different types to equip. You have light, medium, and heavy. And depending on how you mix these up, you're going to settle into the light, medium, or heavy weight category. And these are going to determine your dodge and your passive bonuses. So if you manage to stick into the light category, you're going to have a further dodge, you're actually going to roll out of the way of things, and you're going to deal 20% increased damage, but you will take more damage. If you're in the medium category, you're going to deal 10% increased damage, and your debuffs will last 10% longer, but your dodge is only a short sidestep and not that roll. And if you're heavy, your dodge is a very slow sidestep, but you have the highest damage mitigation, and your block stability is increased by 15%, and the debuffs you apply last 20% longer. So as you can see, I mean, depending on the role that you want, you're gonna need to adjust your gear to match. Now, this isn't set in stone, right? If you wanna be a DPS that wears all heavy armor, then absolutely go ahead, but you need to know what bonuses are there, and that's something to keep in mind. Now, let's talk about the other type of weight that you're gonna have to keep an eye on. So outside of armor weight, you also have inventory weight for crafting materials, inventory weapons, etc. And you're gonna quickly fill up that space once you get going in the game. Believe me, you will very quickly fill it up. And along the way, you're gonna unlock new bag slots for duffel bags and cases, and these are gonna increase your carrying capacity. Now, it's important to keep an eye on your inventory weight because if you go over, you will become encumbered. You're gonna move extremely slow, and it's gonna cost way more resources to fast travel. And to avoid that whole encumbered situation, you can take advantage of the storage shed in each settlement. These are essentially your bank. They do have their own capacity, so you need to make sure to keep an eye on that as well. And another thing to note is that these are not linked. Each storage shed is completely separate from one another. So if you store something in Everfall, it will not be available in Monarch's Bluff. You'll need to load up and then fast travel to move things around. But these storage sheds have a massive weight capacity at first, so you can throw pretty much everything in there and then go back and organize if you need to. Next, let's talk about progression. So when it comes to progressing in New World, we talked about questing and leveling up to the level cap of 60. But what do you get when you level up? Well, each level will give you 3 attribute points to spend in a variety of categories to help define your character. Now, these are important because they will directly influence your combat effectiveness with weapon types. So these combat attributes are strength, which increases your damage with swords, axes, warhammers, and it slightly increases your damage with dexterity-based weapons. Then you have dexterity, which is the opposite side, right? Yin and yang. And this one is going to increase the damage of rapiers, muskets, bows, spears, and slightly increase strength-based weapons. And then we have Intelligence, which increases the damage of your staves and your gauntlets. But Intelligence also increases the effectiveness of any magical perks that your weapons might have, like dealing fire or void damage. So this will be a good stat to invest in if your weapon has a ton of those procs. Next up is Focus, and this dictates your mana regeneration rate, but also increases your life staff effectiveness. So if you're someone who likes healing, Focus is where you want to go. And then lastly is Constitution. This increases your overall health pool, so if you want more health, dump all your points into this one. Now, all of these can be reset freely up until level 20, so you can get a good idea of what each one does and how they kind of affect the weapons that you like to use. However, after level 20, it's gonna cost gold each time, and it does increase every time you reset. So you need to be more cognizant about what you're going to do with those points. So let's go ahead and move into combat, which is really where these attributes are going to benefit you the most. So the core of the game revolves around the new combat system in New World, and the direction they went with is different from most other MMOs out there. Combat is an action-based system where you need to manage stamina to block, use light attacks, heavy attacks, and skills, because this is not a tab target game. So as you're going out and you're kind of engaging in combat with different enemies, it's important to be able to time their attacks and not just spam your attacks, because you're gonna be punished pretty quickly if you decide to do that. Now, don't get this confused, right? This is not a Dark Souls or some like crazy level of insanity where each fight feels like a boss battle and it takes forever, but it's definitely more interactive than World of Warcraft, where you can jump an enemy and nuke them down with a quick rotation. So just be cognizant that there is a little bit more engagement and interactivity to combat than those other games. So in between all of your light attacks and your heavy attacks are also your skills, and these are determined by your weapon type and what types of skills you chose to invest in with something called mastery points. We're gonna get into these in just a moment, but first I want to talk about classes. So New World does feature a classless system where your class is defined by what type of armor and weapons you're using. So if you want to play a quick roguelike character, then wear light armor and use a hatchet or a rapier along with a bow. If you want to be the tank of the party, then wear heavy gear and use a sword and shield along with a great axe. You can easily swap between all of these weapons and become really kind of a dual threat. Now, there are tons of different ways to build your characters by equipping different gear for different strengths and weaknesses. And the nice thing is, New World offers a mastery system for weapons that gives players 2 skill trees per weapon to invest points into each time they level up their proficiency with that weapon type. And these trees are typically split into 2 playstyles. Some are split between PvP and PvE, others are split between dealing damage or healing, and you can split your points between these 2 trees or decide to go all in on one or the other. But at the end of the day, these will define how your character uses that weapon. And one plus here is that just like the combat attributes, you can reset these trees up until level 20, giving you enough time to experiment and find a pair that you really, really like. And right now in New World, there are 12 weapons that you have at your disposal. The Warhammer, the Great Axe, the Life Staff, the Fire Staff, the Sword, the Rapier, the Spear, the Hatchet or Throwing Axe, the Bow, the Musket, the Ice Gauntlet, and the Shield. And all of these can be paired up with any other weapon, so you can kind of not dual wield them, but equip 2 of them at one time. And the only thing that you cannot do that with is the shield. The shield is an offhand that can only be used with the sword, and unfortunately there is no dual wielding in New World at this time. Also, there are no daggers, halberds, pistols, or wands, but we do have some screenshots with a few of these where they're seen, so maybe they'll be coming in a later content update, but right now those 12 are the only ones that we have in the game, and there are very few magic weapons. Next, I want to dive into one of the biggest pieces of New World, and that's the faction systems. These are a huge part of the game, and they're going to be the first major decision that you have to make at level 10. Now, don't get anxiety just because I said these are a major decision. You can switch this choice every 120 days, and you'll be able to move factions if you need to. However, this is still a huge, huge choice, because if you want to play with friends, you need to make sure that all of you pick the same faction. Otherwise, you're going to be opponents out in the world. You won't be able to enter the same forge. You'll be on different sides of a war, and that's going to be a problem, obviously. Now, there are 3 factions that you can choose from right now in New World. You have the Marauders, which are kind of the military-focused soldiers looking to dominate and control. You have the Covenant, which are the religious fanatics who do everything in the name of the light. And you have the Syndicate. The Syndicate are these secretive, Illuminati-style faction that's all about subterfuge and deception. And the choice of a faction is huge because it's going to align you with that faction's efforts. like being able to take advantage of certain perks depending on what zone you control, or maybe a certain faction has strength in numbers and can easily win wars. These are all considerations to weigh in when choosing, especially if you're starting at the very beginning or if you come in extremely late. But honestly, a lot of people choose based on the look, and that's cool too. I mean, I know that I prefer Covenant and Syndicate over Marauders for that exact reason, but hey, it's personal preference, so pick the one that you most align with. Now, if you were to ask me what one of the most talked about features of New Worlds is besides factions, I would have crafting near the very top of my list. The crafting system that this game has come up with is just fantastic. It reminds me of old school RuneScape in a way. It's simple in the design, but it's deep in its execution and the range of things you can do. So for those people who are like me, who just, you know, sometimes you just want to chill and kind of work on some trade skills like logging or mining, you can totally do that. I remember some great times when I was lobbying with some other players, just chatting about stuff, and I can totally see New World Fishing hitting that same vibe. But anyway, so long story short, the gathering stuff is really laid back and fun to do, and the actual crafting portion is also very well laid out. So when you're creating items, you have all of your materials, but you can also add a special resource called Azoth to increase your chances of a higher rarity or crafting an item with a gem slot. And so you're probably asking, what type of trade skills are there? Well, in terms of gathering, you have mining, skinning, logging, fishing, and harvesting. Harvesting is for things like vegetables and hemp plants. Then in terms of refining, you have smelting, stone cutting, woodworking, tanning, and weaving. And then for the actual crafting portion, you have weaponsmithing, armoring, jewel crafting, engineering, arcana, cooking, and furnishing, which is furniture for your house. And yes, you can buy a house and it sets a fast travel location. They're expensive and you can kind of deck it out the way you want to. So as you level up all of these crafting skills, you're going to gain access to better and more powerful recipes. So it's important to, at the very least, at the very bare minimum, do the ones that benefit your playstyle. But keep in mind, there is no limit to these. You don't have to specialize in one or two like you do in World of Warcraft. You can work on as many of these trade skills as you would like, and you can only focus on these. If you want to be someone who's just a crafter for their primary existence, that's great. You can do that. So that's one cool thing I really like about this, and I feel like it hits a really good balance between approachability and depth. So let's move into the last two categories, and that is PvP and PvE game modes. So for PvP, when New World was first announced, it was touted as a survival PvP sandbox. And then people were like, we don't like that. So then it moved to a PvP-centric MMO, and people were like, we don't like that either. So now it's just a normal MMO with completely opt-in PvP, no more full loot or anything like that. And this means that if you have PvP turned off, you cannot fight other players, but you can also not be ganked and you can't be griefed. So some people like this, some people don't, but they did implement some PvP modes to help make up for it. So the first one is the kind of bare minimum, and that's duels. These are your classic 1v1 showdown that can be declared at any time between two players, even on the same faction. Then we have Outpost Rush. So Outpost Rush is the most recently announced mode, and this sends 40 players to an island to take part in a 20 versus 20 match to control 3 outposts, gather resources, craft siege weapons, and kill bosses on the map for special buffs. It does look pretty fun, but we'll have to see what it actually plays like once the beta is here. Next up, we have the big spotlight PvP mode, and that's War. So when a faction loses control over a territory, it's pushed into a contested state. At this point, other factions can declare war for that territory. And this is a 100 versus 100 battle that will have the faction who controls the territory defend their fort while the opposing faction tries to take it from them. If they're able to take it, then they will own that zone and also reap its benefits. If the losing faction wants to retake that territory they just lost, then they will need to push the territory back into a contested state and declare war themselves, repeating the process. And then they also have to win the war. And this is going to be a regular thing for guilds and factions vying over the best zone buffs, so these are going to happen all the time. Now, wars are also scheduled, so this is something you'll go actually sign up for, and it'll be like Thursday, 1 o'clock, we're going to war. So this is not a random thing, and you can plan around it. And lastly, we have good old-fashioned open world PvP that simply requires two players from opposing factions both be in PvP mode and then just run into each other out in the world and decide it's time to duke it out. So this is the one that you'll most likely see all of the time, anywhere and everywhere, for those people who really, really like to PvP. So that wraps up the PvP modes. Let's move into the PvE modes. So when it comes to PvE offerings, New World was incredibly scarce during its last open beta, so much so that the devs took it back into alpha status to correct it. Now, luckily, what they've come up with looks much better than what they had a year ago, so let's go ahead and go through it. So their most recent addition is their version of dungeons called Expeditions. These are five-man instances where you tackle traditional dungeon content. You have trash mobs, bosses, loot to collect, and right now there are six of these available at launch. Amrine Temple, Garden of Genesis, Lazarus Instrumentality, Dynasty Shipyard, Shattered Obelisk, and The Depths. Besides Expeditions, they also have the single offering that they had last year, which is still available, and this is the arena where players faced off against a single high-level boss called the Spriggan. And while this was a neat idea, the fight was very boring and devolved into a simple kite and DPS encounter, and it just wasn't good. It was incredibly boring. But they decided to kind of zhuzh this up a little bit, make it better. And these arenas are still hidden out in the world. There are multiple of them, and players will need to go out and find a key which allows them to enter. Once you enter the arena, that key is consumed and the battle immediately begins. So do not enter unless you're ready with your team, you're fully buffed up, and things are looking good. These are balanced towards groups of five, and once you kill this Spriggan or whichever kind of arena boss is there, you have a chance at a legendary piece of gear. The next PvE event takes place out in the open world, and these are Corrupted Breaches. And these are going to open up all across a zone over time, and as you leave them out there, they're going to go from a minor breach to a major breach. And these are going to be guarded by corrupted enemies who are stronger than your normal wolf or your drowned. And these enemies are also shrouded in a mist that will slowly decrease your corruption resistance, which means you either need to have a resistance potion handy or be able to kite them out of the mist to avoid taking extra damage. These are geared towards 5 players, but the minor ones you can do solo, and they typically start around level 20 to 25. The last PvE mode we're going to talk about is one that we heard a lot about early on, and then suddenly nothing else was said, and these are invasions. So invasions are scheduled events that will take place with 50 players defending a fort against corrupted enemies from those breaches we just talked about. Players will need to craft siege weapons, use strategy, and fortify their teammates to hold off the army of creatures that are trying to break down the doors. If the creatures manage to win, the territory suffers and loses upgrades such as crafting stations and fort protections. So throughout the invasion, you're going to be dealing with a variety of enemies who focus on certain tasks. First up, you have the grunts, and these are going to swarm and attempt to take down players. They're weak individually, but very strong in groups, kind of like zombies. Then you have the raiders. Now, the raiders are tough infantry who focus on taking down as many players as possible, and they're very, very good at melee combat. Snipers are going to form the back line and deal damage to players from a distance, attempting to soften those defenses so the raiders and grunts can easily pick off wounded players. Bombers are just like they sound. They have bombs strapped to their back, they run at structures, and they blow themselves up to help crumble your fort. Then you have brutes. These are massive beasts who are purely looking to destroy any structure, but will attack players if they pull enough aggro. Lastly are bosses. Each invasion will have some bosses that will spawn, and some are going to be focused on destroying structures, others are going to be focused on killing players, so these will need to be taken down immediately. Now, if players manage to survive the time limit, they'll win the battle, they'll keep all of their upgrades, and they'll earn experience, currency, and loot. So guys, that wraps this one up, the kind of ultimate, massive starter guide, catch-up guide, however you want to call this thing, to New World. Hopefully there was some new stuff in there for you, and if you were out of the loop, I hope this helped really kind of catch you up. And guys, thank you so much for watching. Thanks for all the subscriptions lately and all of the attention. I really appreciate it. And I plan to have much more New World content once beta hits. So if you want to stay up to date, learn some cool stuff, and really just keep up with all things New World, consider subscribing. I really appreciate it. But as always, thank you guys so much. This has been Vulcan, and I will talk to you next time.